The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. I'm sure you're aware of the philosophical question, if a tree falls in a deserted forest where no one can hear the sound, did it make a noise? Carry the principle one step forward. If no one saw it fall, did it ever fall in the first place? Now, don't answer these questions too quickly. No one has ever been able to resolve them to everybody's satisfaction.
And what does the Sahib require of me?
Priestess, I am cursed with the habit of gambling.
The curse can't be lifted.
No, Priestess. It has been predicted I can stop only when the sun shines at midnight, when snow falls in the jungle, and when the deer turns upon and slays the pursuing tiger.
Is that all?
Is that all?
This matter can be arranged.
Our mystery drama, The Eye of the Idol, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Sam Dan and stars Tony Roberts. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Ship me somewhere east of Suez, says Mr. Rudyard Kipling, where the best is like the worst, where there is no Ten Commandments, and a man can raise a thirst. Ah, yes, we shall never see those days again, and perhaps it's for the best, when a handful of British soldiers and civil servants ruled the entire teeming subcontinent of India. India, that ancient and eternal land of mystery and romance. And this is a story that took place many years ago when India was called the British Raj.
Tanu! Tanu! Where can a lazy scoundrel be hiding? Tanu!
Has the heavenborn called?
Well, what have I been standing here doing? Well, snap to, look sharp, step lively. I dine tonight with the parents of the Sahiba Penelope, understand?
Each word from the presence fills this ignorant person with magnificent enlightenment.
Yes, lay out my best shirt and place thou therein the silver studs.
Sooner than say this, thy servant would rather eat dirt. But I must disobey the heavenborn's command.
All right, now look here, Danu.
The silver studs cannot be placed in the shirt because they are still in the clutches of Mustafa Ali, the moneylender.
Oh, Lord. All right, we'll improvise. Hast thou drawn my bath?
If it pleases the presence, I have not.
Well, how can it please me, thou benighted fool? I've had a hard day at the office. I want my bath.
With your honor's permission, it is not possible at this time. The well must be repaired before the water may flow.
Well, I remember I told you to have it fixed.
I have done even what the favored one has commanded. I went to the office where these things may be arranged. The Babu of the accounts would not consent.
Why, that arrogant little clerk. What did he say?
He said, and I repeat, say unto Farnsworth Sahib that we will see first the color of his money.
All right. We'll sort this out later. Meanwhile, place thou the dress suit, the shirt, and the razor in a bag. I will bathe and shave at the club.
The club. This letter came for you.
From whom?
It is even from the selfsame club that the Blessed One has just now mentioned.
Well, give it to me. Why didst thou not leave it on the table where I could see it?
If the Glorious One will permit, had I left it on the table, The bad news it contains would have spread through the entire house.
Why dost thou say it's bad news?
One can feel the evil spirit churning about within.
Mr. John K. Farnsworth, Bubbling Well Road. Dear Jack, I'm sorry I must notify... What's this? New regulations? All members in arrears barred from club privileges until back dues. Respectfully, Percy Smollett. Oh, they can't do this to me. I'm a charter member.
It is a year since the Magnificent One has paid a single rupee.
Oh, shut up. I have to have a bath. Take thou the bucket, go to the well in the village. Well, why dost thou stand there, Danou? Be off, fill the tub.
Before this reputationless clod enters the bathroom, I suggest the Invincible One go in there first.
Well, why would I want to go into the bathroom before thou bringest the water?
And hold at the ready the double-barreled rifle.
Fool! Why would I bring a rifle into the bathroom?
Because there is, lying in the tub, a cobra.
A cobra? How did a cobra get into my bathtub?
It must have slithered up through the sluice.
Oh, this is absolutely all I need.
They enjoy the warmth of the pipes.
Yes, I'll give him something to enjoy. Put the gun together for me.
It is even now assembled and loaded and waiting by the door.
Between the sharks at the club and the snakes in my house. Look at him lying there. As if he owned the place. You think the beggar was paying rent and taxes? Well, how do you like this? Ah, that did him. Ugly brute. 15 feet if he's an inch. Danou?
Yes?
Come in. Get rid of him.
With your honor's permission, soon.
Hello? Not soon. Now.
No, but we must wait.
For what?
The mate. Even now, it is probably crawling through the pipe on the trail of its beloved. May I remind the unconquerable one to hold the other barrel ready.
Some mornings, it doesn't pay to get up. But on a day like this, it doesn't even pay to be alive.
And thus... You have met my master, Farnsworth Sahib. He makes much noise and many threats because he is afraid people will discover that he has a kind heart. But, more important, many people have already discovered that he has a foolish head, especially where games of cards are concerned. Although he sees himself victorious like a lion at the end of the evening, he is always shorn. Like a lamb.
Shut the other one, Danou. Come, get rid of these ugly things. You don't have to be afraid. They're dead.
Now, one may truly marvel at and safely touch their awesome beauty.
Just get the filthy things out of here.
See, this is the female. She died for him. She heard the shot. Still, she came. Preferring the companionship of death to the loneliness of life.
Wilt thou take those disgusting things out of here and toss them on the trash heap?
It shall be even as your honor commands.
I knocked on the door, but no one answered, so I came... Oh, what's that?
Oh, no. Please be not of me, my darling. Don't faint.
Oh,
don't faint.
Oh, keep them away from me. Keep them away.
All right, my dearest. They're dead.
Where did they come from?
Well, they were in the bathtub.
The bathtub?
Well, you know how cobras are. They like warm places.
The bathtub? And you expect me to live in this house after we're married?
Oh, darling, we'll fix it up prettily.
I'm very glad our engagement is broken.
We'll put up curtains and all the other foolish little things so dear to a woman's heart.
Did you hear what I said? The engagement is broken.
Dearest, I always hear what you say. You said the engagement. What? What do you mean, it's broken? Who broke our engagement?
Three people made that decision.
Three?
First, Daddy. He was at the club. There it was, on the bulletin board, for all the world to see. Suspended for non-payment of dues.
Uh-oh.
I came by to warn you. Don't come to dinner tonight. Daddy's lying in wait.
But I can explain.
Second, there's Mother, who never approved of you, to begin with. Who felt she was throwing away her daughter on some second-rate assistant district superintendent of the railway and telegraph department.
I am not a second-rate assistant district superintendent. I am a second deputy assistant.
And third, John Kenneth Farnsworth.
Why do you call me John Kenneth Farnsworth?
Because this is a formal occasion. I am serving notice that I intend to break our engagement.
You can't do that.
I have just done it.
Penelope.
You lied to me.
My darling, I never meant...
You never meant to keep your word.
I tried.
You didn't try hard enough. If there's a losing horse anywhere at any racetrack in India, you'll bet on him.
In the interests of accuracy, my darling, I have been losing mostly on mares and maiden fillies.
You promised me you would stop all gambling.
But I meant to.
I release you from your vow. I free you from your obligation. We are no longer engaged.
I thought you loved me.
I do love you. But I'll get over it. I'll meet someone else. Someone who prefers me to a night of cards and a day at the races.
Please, darling, listen.
Someone who shall not sentence me to a life of poverty. Someone who will not gamble away the roof over my head and the bread from the mouths of my children.
I've changed.
You speak in echoes, John Kenneth Farnsworth. I would return your ring, except you had already pledged it to Mustafa Ali, the money lender.
Penelope! Penelope, come back! She's gone. Tanu, she's gone.
Yes.
What am I going to do?
Find another.
Oh, who could replace my Penelope?
There is the daughter of the colonel of the cavalry regiment. The tall, fair-skinned blonde.
Oh, you mean the gawky albino?
There is Miss Leslie.
She squints.
True. But she has an income of 2,000 rupees per month.
Well, let us stop this melancholy recital of the seedy charms of mediocre women. I have lost the sun. Am I to have my way lightened by flickering candles? Get me a rope.
A rope? What does the presence propose to do with a rope?
Hang myself. Is there another use for a rope? Quickly.
For the sake of the Sahiba Penelope.
The rope, quickly. I cannot live without her.
But it is not necessary for the presence to live without the Sahib.
Thou hast heard. She has broken our engagement.
If the protector of the poor will but listen. The Sahiba is angry. Because of the gambling.
Yeah.
If she can be shown that the heaven-born renounces this sin, the Sahiba will relent, and there shall be connubial bliss.
Dost thou not realize that the gambling is with me like a fever in the blood? I will stop gambling when the sun shines at midnight, when snow falls in the jungle, when the deer turns upon and slays the pursuing tiger.
But she does not love thee. Is the Sahiba like the she-cobra that welcomed death to be with her mate? If the center of the universe will only deign to listen, this most unworthy one has an idea.
An idea? What sort of idea?
Why does the Sahiba object to gambling?
Why?
Mm-hmm.
Because it's immoral, I suppose.
No. Because your honor always loses. But reflect. If I could show your honor a way to gamble and never lose...
What do you mean? Never lose?
Always win.
Always win.
Every time.
How is such a thing possible? How? Very well, how? A way to play and always win. Why, that's like having a license to print money, isn't it?
Even better, it's like having the Philosopher's Stone. Well, this sounds like something worth waiting to hear, and we shall hear all about it in Act Two. According to Mr. Grantland Rice, when the one great scorer comes to write against your name, he marks not that you won or lost, but how you played the game. That refers, of course, to the game of life. The game of cards, however, is completely different, especially when money changes hands.
What sayest thou, Danu? There is a way to gamble and never lose.
It is even so.
I don't believe it.
And yet, if your honor will permit me, it shall be revealed.
When?
At the proper time.
Danu, dost thou say this to divert me from my purpose, which is to hang myself?
Well, of course. That did happen to be why I said such a thing. Could I let Farnsworth Sahib throw away his life because of the whim of some chit of a girl? How foolish are the English. How eager to die for love. And yet, how was I to keep my promise? Was there a way to gamble and never lose? And if so, how could I find it? I decided to seek out Laila, the witch. Who knows? Perhaps she might have heard something in the winds that blow between the garden of Genaden and the gates of Gehenna.
Why dost thou seek Laila? What is thy desire?
To find a way to gamble and never lose.
This thing cannot be. Life itself is a gamble. And in the end, all must lose.
Yes, I know.
Then why ask?
It is for my master, Farnsworth Sahib.
An Englishman?
He has a good heart.
Why does he gamble?
It is sickness.
Yes. It kills more foreigners than the fever.
Is it possible to help him?
Leave me to think upon it.
Danu! Come here at once. Now, you said you knew of a way that I could gamble and never lose. Now, what is it?
If the favored one will reflect, his servant said he would find a way.
Just how long is this supposed to take? Someone stands without. Open the door. And who is this?
Protector of the poor. I am a holy woman. I sell charms and potions and spells.
No, there is no need of thy wares in this house of sorrow.
House of sorrow? Has one died here?
One is about to die.
And what is the illness?
Love.
Yes, love comes and goes and kills many. And yet her hand may be stayed. By this charm I can give thee.
Oh, Holy Mother, I prepare myself to meet my Maker. I cannot fill my mind with heathen tricks. But here, take this, my last rupee, and give me thy blessing. I travel soon to a far country from which none may return.
Thy last rupee. There is a kind heart. I give my blessing. And now, I shall leave.
What were you discussing to know? Yes, this gambling system of the vine. Well, what is it?
By your honor's favor, it shall only take a little while longer. For what purpose had Laila come to the house? Had she cast a spell on him? How would she be able to help? Had I been mistaken? Or when she left, had she given me a certain look as if to say, come to me soon?
I know now why the master gambles.
Truly?
He gambles heavily for two reasons. First, to wager huge sums to risk one's substance gives a man a devil-may-care reputation as an adventurer.
Can this be true?
Second, he believes that losing money to people is a way to buy their affection and goodwill.
Oh, what wisdom! Oh, Holy One, why dost thou not speak these words of enlightenment to Farnsworth Sahib himself?
Would he listen to an old heathen sorcerer?
But if someone could tell him... Oh, Layla, what is to be done?
We must cure thy master of the gambling.
Yes, but how?
Thou didst promise thou wouldst show him a way to gamble and always win.
Yes, but even if I could find it, how would winning cure him?
He has tried losing, has he not? That has not opened his eyes. Very well. Let us see what winning may reveal to him.
Well, how is this to be arranged?
Listen, thou, and closely.
Why have we come here?
Patience, Your Honor. Just a little bit longer.
I am a complete fool. I let you drag me out to the jungle in the middle of the night.
We are protected by the emanations from the shrine.
The shrine? What shrine?
The shrine of Azari.
The shrine of Azari. What does one do there?
One finds the magic.
What kind of magic?
Whatever magic one is seeking. In the case of the Anointed One, the magic that makes him a constant winner.
This I have to see. Where is it?
It is not much further. See, just ahead, a clearing. And the ancient statue. Yes, the statue of Azari.
That shapeless piece of clay? That's Azari? What is that shining thing near the top of it?
'Tis the Eye of Fortune. The Eye of Azari. It sees all things.
Oh, great goddess Azari, thy servant seeks thy favor.
Who's that?
'Tis Layla, the high priestess of the goddess Azari.
She looks familiar. Wait, I know her. She's that beggar lady who came to the door the other day.
Ah, yes. She will sometimes wear that guise. She had come to test your honor.
To test me? Why?
To see if your honor is worthy.
Worthy? Worthy of what?
Worthy to receive help from the goddess Azari.
Oh, is that a fact, huh? Well, how does she know I'd be here? I mean, how do I know this isn't a trick thou hast arranged with her? I would put nothing past thee to know.
Approach the shrine. Approach.
Do even as she says, Sahib.
Well, this is humbug. I'm going home.
Approach.
Here. It is the goddess that speaks through her mouth. The goddess Azari
herself.
Thy name is Farnsworth Sahib. The high priestess, Lila, says thou art good of heart, but thy heart is troubled. Speak.
Well, that's true, I suppose.
And what is the source of thy sorrow, Sahib?
I like to gamble. I just don't like it.
Yes?
I have to. I mean, that's all there is to it. I simply have to.
And what wouldst thou have from the goddess Azari?
Well, assuming that we're dealing here with a legitimate proposition, as long as I have to gamble,
I would like to be able to win.
Could the goddess arrange it so that I could become one of those who walks off with the money?
The goddess Azari speaks through me. The answer is yes.
Yes.
Master, thou art saved.
I can play cards now and win?
Constantly.
Oh, and the horses, I bet. They'll come in first?
All the time.
Oh, wait a minute.
The goddess says to me, her high priestess, do thou but lend the Sahib Farnsworth for however long a time he wants to keep it. The eye from my head.
The eye?
The eye. I take it from the head of the goddess, and I give this precious jewel to thee.
Jewel? It's only a piece of glass.
And a diamond is only a lump of coal.
What am I supposed to do with it?
Keep it on thy person. It will serve thee as the all-seeing eye when thou sittest down at the card table and when thou standest at the rail of the racetrack.
The all-seeing eye. What am I going to see?
The winners, the winning hand, the winning horse.
Why, that's simply impossible.
True. It is impossible for those who have no faith.
Oh, goddess Azari, let me assure thee that my master Farnsworth Sahib has great faith. Faith fills his entire heart, soul, and body.
Thy servant has spoken, Farnsworth Sahib. Dost thou agree with his words?
Please, Farnsworth Sahib, please.
Oh, well. Why not? I'll give it a try.
I would too. After all, what does he have to lose? And it doesn't matter where or when we find a gambler, does it? They seem to be a race apart, filled with their own symbols and superstitions. And besides, your true dyed-in-the-wool gambler will try anything once. And we shall try the third act shortly. You may have heard it said, true luck consists not in holding the best cards at the table, but in knowing just when to rise and go home. To which we might also add, and knowing when to stay in the pot, and when to fold, and when to bet, call, or raise. But if one could do all these things consistently, it would be more than luck. It would be because one possessed an all-seeing eye, which is what our story is all about.
Danu! Danu!
Does the heaven-born call his servant?
Listen, was it a dream?
A dream?
Did I dream, Danu, that thou and I walked into the jungle and came upon a shrine to the goddess, what was the name of that goddess? I forget.
Azari!
Yes, and she said to me that I could... Wait a minute. How dost thou know the name of the goddess?
I was there with the favored one.
Thou art there? With me? Then it was no dream. And this piece of glass...
The eye of the goddess Azari.
It's supposed to show me the winning hand at cards, the winning horse at the track.
It is even, as the fortunate one says.
I don't believe it. I can't believe it.
Does the sublime one have the eye?
The glass in my pocket.
Then at the racetrack, even now... Are the horses striving with each other?
Yes, well, what's the point of going to the racetrack? I don't have a single rupee to wager.
True, true. But come, my lord, who knows what visions await? See the horses stand in line.
Yes, I see.
Is there one that meets with my lord's favor?
I have no money. If I did, I'd bet it and lose it. I was a fool to come here. No, Danu, I shall go home and put an end to my sorry self.
But the eye of Azari.
A piece of brightly colored glass.
And it shows the heaven-born nothing?
Nothing, Danu, nothing.
My lord, On this paper is written many things, much information.
Yes, I know that paper, Danu. How well I know that paper. It is called a tout sheet.
And yet, it speaks much useful information.
Well, I see the names of eight animals, and each is a stubborn brute that runs fast or slow according to some whim of its own mysterious, brutish nature.
Yes, but still
and
you...
And furthermore, Fatima...
Fatima?
Fatima. I see her break quickly at the start. She leads at the eighth, increases at the quarter, falters at the half. No, my girl. Go! See that? She regains the stride. She enters the stretch. She's neck and neck. And now she forges ahead. She wins driving. Fatima.
You see, it is even here written on the paper.
Fatima. I have seen Fatima win, but the race has not yet begun.
Oh, it is the eye of Azari.
What eye of Azari?
That sees everything, even Fatima.
At 20-1.
Fatima is 20-1.
It is written.
Is it possible?
There is the man with the book. Surely the presence will wish to wager, say, £10 on Fatima?
Danu, don't rush me. Fatima, I saw her win. Stand, Danu. Let me write her name on this piece of paper. Fatima, £10. Signed, Jack Farnsworth. All right, now then, Danu. Run thou to the book, Sahib, and place this in his hand.
I did even as I was told. And then there was the gun. And the horses raced forward like tortured spirits rushing to escape from Gehenna. And the little mare, Fatima, did lead them all. And no one else, it seemed, had seen fit to bet on her. So, as she raced about the track, there was a silence as the crowd's favorites lagged behind. And only the voice of my master could be heard in that vast throng.
Come on, Fatima! You can do it, girl! I've seen you do it before! Come on, Fatima! Come on, girl!
When the day was done, and we departed from the ring where the book Sahib hauled forth...
Let me add this up. This is 200 for Fatima, 300 for Salia, 400 for Chalunda. It's not a bad day. What sayest thou, Danu?
Yes, it is the eye that has shown the invincible one how each race would end.
Yes, Danu, it is the eye. For without it, I would never bet on such mangy pieces of horse flesh that have today won me this fortune.
And where does your honor go now?
Now, Danu? Now I go forth to the club. I go forth to shear at a place where formerly I was shorn. I shall recount all that occurred when I come home. It's Percy Smollett. Good evening, Percy.
Well, Jack.
Oh, I see the club is having a dance.
Well, Jack, I would like to avoid any unpleasantness.
Of course. We always have a dance on Saturday nights.
Jack, now, you're supposed to be barred from the premises until...
Until I pay my dues. Yes, that's right.
Jack, I don't make the rules.
Of course not, Percy. Where is my account? I wish to settle it.
Now?
Well, a thing that's worth doing is best done promptly.
Well, it's a rather large sum.
Well, I happen to have some cash in my pocket. Let me look. Oh, well, you think I have enough here?
Hey, God, monsieur, what? Jack, what happened? Did some aunt of yours, some nice old lady, finally close her eyes?
Let us say that some nice old lady finally opened mine. Shall you give me a receipt?
Well, yes. Why don't we step into my office? Now, let me sign this little receipt. And here you are.
I thank you, Percy.
Of course.
Tell me, the usual bunch around this evening?
Yes, why, of course. In the card room, naturally. I was headed that way myself.
You suppose I might sit in for a few hounds?
Oh, hi, Jack. Now that you're a member in good standing once again, well, you're as welcome as the very air we breathe.
My bet, I suppose. I say, a pound. Percy?
Well, I say, let's make it a fiver. Jack? Jack, it's your bet.
My bet.
Jack, Tom open for a pound. I say a fiver. What do you say?
I say a tenner.
Two Jacks.
Two ladies.
Now that's luck. Three kings.
Three aces.
And I'm thoroughly cleaned. I may as well fold. Jack, you lucky devil. And did you find a way to see through the backs of the cards?
And soon, my master became the richest man in the club. Everybody deferred to him and made much of him. But there was one who still shunned him.
Penelope! Penelope! Please wait! Please!
Oh. Yes?
Penelope, you won't see me when I come calling. You won't talk to me at the club. You cut me dead at Paletti's and every other place we run into each other.
Can't you take the hint?
Please, Penelope.
It's a beautiful morning. You're spoiling my ride.
But, darling, why won't you marry me now? Your parents no longer disapprove.
Oh, no. They think you're quite a catch.
Yes, you said you wouldn't marry me because you were afraid you would lose the roof over your head one day. Are you still afraid?
Yes.
But I'm rich, Penelope. I am easily the wealthiest man on the station.
And every penny comes to you from gambling. And therefore, one day, every penny can leave you the same way it came.
Oh, no, darling, never.
You are having a streak of luck. It can turn.
No, it isn't luck. It's you.
Yes?
I'll tell you this to prove I love you. Now, you mustn't think I'm mad, but I have the eye of the goddess, and with it, I can see all the winning cards, all the winning horses.
Oh, my darling boy, you have gone mad.
Penelope, listen.
No, this proves once and for all you must rid yourself of this gambling sickness before it destroys you completely.
Penelope, stay.
I shall come back only when you have cast aside this accursed habit forever.
Yes, no. My original instinct was correct. I should hang myself.
My lord has asked for a way to gamble and win. It has been found. Why this further talk?
Penelope will have none of it. Dost thou understand? And without her, nothing is worthwhile in this life here below.
Then give it up. The cards, the horses.
Give it up, give it. How can I give it up?
My lord, perhaps this can be accomplished.
How?
Did not my lord once declare a set of conditions under which he would abandon the pursuit of the wagering forever?
I don't remember to know.
But thy servant recalls. Come to the jungle, to the shrine of Azari, and to the high priestess.
And what is this? The Sahib wishes to return the eye?
It is no longer of use to me.
Hold to the light, the all-seeing eye. Tell me what is revealed.
Why, it's light. It's getting light. The sun is rising.
How can the sun rise, Sahib? It is midnight.
Look, the sun. You see how it lights up the jungle? Never has there been such a brilliant sunlight. Thunder? How is this possible? Look what falls from the sky. Snow. Snow.
Snow in the jungle.
Of course, it's snow. It's covering the trees. I'm freezing. Snow. A tiger? A tiger? I have no gun.
I'm unarmed.
Have no fear, Sahib. Thou shalt be protected.
Protected? By what? By whom? That's a tiger.
See, the tiger flees for its life. It is being pursued by a deer.
A deer?
See, the deer catches the tiger, falls upon it.
A deer turns on a tiger?
The Sahib has seen it with his own eyes.
Yes, I have seen it.
Thou art free now. For has not the Sahib said, the gambling is a fever in the blood. I will stop when the sun shines at midnight, when the snow falls in the jungle, and when the deer slays the tiger. Remember?
Yes, I remember.
Thou hast seen these things?
Yes.
Where are they now? The sun at midnight, the snow in the jungle, the tiger slain by the deer.
Where?
The moon shines through the trees. There is not, never was, can never be any snow. And but 50 yards from here is a deer slain by a tiger, as is proper to the law of the jungle.
But I saw the sun and the snow and the conquering deer.
Thou didst see what the gambler sees when the fever runs high in the blood. Visions, phantoms, illusions. And now the fever has burned itself out. Go.
Tanu, I just had the strangest dream. I can't make heads or tails of the thing. It was snowing, and deer were killing tiger, and that old beggar lady was... Oh, what's the difference?
Does the heaven-born go to the club tonight?
The club? Why would I want to go to the club?
The protector of the poor goes there every night to play cards.
I don't see the point of that anymore. I mean, why should I sit around in a sweaty room, drink too much whiskey, and throw cards at a surly group of nervous, bad-tempered people?
Why, indeed.
Especially when I can walk about in the fresh air, enjoy the beautiful moonlight with the lovely Penelope.
Why, indeed. And so Jack Farnsworth has made his choice. And you will agree with it or disagree with it, according to your own personal views on love, life, and gambling. And I shall have some personal views of my own for you shortly. Hear people say of something or other that it's in the cards. Just precisely what does that mean? Is it possible that all the cards will always fall according to some prearranged pattern? Is it then also possible to predict that pattern by following laws of averages and probabilities? Was Jack Farnsworth's all-seeing eye merely a concentration on the past performances of horses? You can call it the eye of Azari, or you can call it applied psychology. Perhaps in the end, it's all one and the same thing. Our cast included Tony Roberts, Earl Hammond, and Roberta Maxwell. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. This is E.G. Marshall, inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.